Hello, Lakers Nation. Welcome in to the LakersNation.com podcast. It's game day. Lakers, Raptors tonight, 6:30 Pacific time tip. Hopefully you join us over on YouTube, youtube.com/LakersNation, or playback, playback.tv/LakersNation. Hang out with us during the game as well as after for the post-game show. For today's show, we're going to break down what to expect from tonight's game from the Raptors side of things. We'll get a little intel from Luca Rosano of Raptors Nation. Also get into what we're looking for on the Lakers side. And we'll finish things up with a little bit of trade talk. I may flip those. We'll see. But we'll talk trades a bit as well on today's show. Joining me right now, it is Luca Rosano from Raptors Nation. Make sure you guys go check them out. Do a phenomenal job covering the Raptors. Luca, how you doing?
Trevor, I'm doing good. Thanks again for having me. I know this is the second time these two teams have been playing in the last week. So it's good to see the Lakers again.
It's kind of weird, isn't it, that they played twice and this is it, right? They meet in the NBA Finals, which seems unlikely on both sides, really. But they're not going to see each other again until next season. I don't know if I like that. I kind of like it more spread out, where you see a team maybe once early in the season, once later in the season, rather than two games so close together like this.
I can't remember the last time it's been like this, because you're right. From my memory, it's usually a matchup earlier in the season, and then just would see the Lakers, and like usually around that March, April timeline. So yeah, this is probably like the first time in a while that I can remember the Raptors taking on the Lakers in particular, literally twice in the span of like a week and a couple of days.
Well, I mean, given that it has been just a week or so, we'll take a quick peek here at the Raptors and what has happened. Obviously, they haven't played a bunch of games since the last time they played the Lakers, but they did have a few things happen here. So you've got right after playing the Lakers last, the Raptors beat the Sacramento Kings on the second night of a back-to-back, no less. So we could talk a bit about that, and then lost to Denver and then lost in Sacramento as they started off this road trip. How did the overtime win against the Kings, second night of a back-to-back, was that a surprise for you guys?
I mean, there was a ton of electricity in the air. The Raptors, of course, retired Vince Carter's jersey, so I feel like they had an extra boost, pep in their step, and that was just an incredible game. Like, that was the closest thing to a playoff game we have gotten in Toronto in a while. So everybody was amped. You know, RJ Barrett had a great game. Grady Dick, of course, two Raptors who had big games against the Lakers in their previous matchup. So yeah, the Raptors, they were definitely not favored to win that game on the second night of back to back, but their effort level was very, very focused from the get go, and they were able to hold on for the win there in overtime.
That's right. It slipped my mind that was the Vince Carter jersey retirement game. So that makes sense that there was a little extra energy in the building for that one. But I know we've got, and we are recording this right before the Raptors take on the Clippers here on Saturday evening, but we got some news that the Raptors are getting somebody back. Emmanuel Quickley, what's the situation there with him? Assuming he gets through this Clippers game, you know, unscathed, are we imagining he's going to play on a back-to-back against the Lakers? What's the update there on Quickley?
Well, Quickley's only played one game prior to this Clippers game for the season. Of course, he played that first half against the Cavaliers, ended up injuring himself. He's been out with the pelvic injury, and that's a really good point. You know, because it's the second night of a back-to-back, who knows if the Raptors are going to have Quickley play. If he does play, I would assume it would be on limited minutes. But Emmanuel Quickley, he is available to play. That is the report from Los Angeles ahead of the Clippers game at the time of this recording. So that's great news for the Raptors, because he has been out for basically the entirety of the season. And what Quickley is going to help this team a lot with, Trevor, is their ability to close out games, because the Raptors, they've actually put forth good efforts in some of these previous defeats. Mm-hmm. But what continues to be an issue with this team, they clean it up a bit with how they started games, obviously against the Lakers. That's how they lost that game. They just came out completely flat. Los Angeles took advantage. But also in the fourth quarter, they have just been abysmal. They got their number one allowed in the fourth quarter in the early part of the season. So I don't know what's going on, but the fourth quarter flips on and this team just forgets how to play basketball. They take off the pressure. They're turning the ball over a ton, just making silly mistakes. So hopefully having their floor general out there and Emmanuel Quickley is going to help clean things up and allow this team to remain competitive in the fourth, and hopefully for the Raptors, close out some of these games and wins.
And this is a big addition for them to get Quickly back. He's a major, major piece for this team. And for the Lakers specifically, trying to defend him is not going to be easy. Now, I know the Lakers have inserted Cam Reddish into the starting lineup to try to help shore up the defense of that starting five, but would have to imagine Reddish is probably going to defend RJ Barrett. So it'll be interesting to see if anybody can stick with Quickly, who does live up to his name. He is pretty speedy if he indeed is a go for the matchup on the second night of a back-to-back with the Lakers. So as far as RJ Barrett goes, I was really impressed with him the last time the two teams played. What have you guys seen out of him this season? Because he does seem to be, well, and maybe this changes with Quickly in the mix, but he seems to be the engine for this team right now.
Yeah, he's really thrived being the number one scoring option with all the injuries with Barnes out, especially. Yeah. I mean, he's just been phenomenal. And remember, he was a big reason why the Raptors made that big comeback against you guys. That third quarter turnaround when the Raptors were making that comeback, making it somewhat of a game, RJ Barrett was in the thick of that. 33 points, 12 assists, 5 rebounds. He continuously is doing a good job of getting downhill, finishing. His efficiency has been just the standout thing for me. Like, he has been putting up these good numbers on efficient stat lines. I mean, minus the Nuggets performance, that was probably one of his worst shooting performances in a Raptors jersey since the trade, but he has just been super efficient. He's been aggressive. He's been able to, you know, hit the three ball, and really, like, his numbers should be even more inflated if he's getting another call or two. Like, this is a guy who's doing all of this despite not getting to the free throw line a whole ton. So Emmanuel Quickly, I mean, he's really been that guy for the Raptors. And like you said, it will be interesting to see now how they kind of spread the wealth, because another guy who's seen an uptick in his production, Grady Dick, he is coming off a bad game against Sacramento. So that's something I'm looking forward to in this game against the Clippers and the Lakers, how he responds, because he's been on the heater as well. But kind of having Quickly come back, you would think he's going to be, the secondary scoring option with Dick being the third with Barnes out. So it's going to be interesting to see how they distribute shot selections. But RJ, I mean, he's been doing a good job, even, you know, off the pick and roll. He's been playing really well with Grady. They kind of formed a little duo with all the injuries that have happened. Yeah. So I think having another floor spacer, a guy in Quickly who can knock down threes, knock down shots, that's just going to continue to help RJ's game, especially when he, you know, attracts attention when he is getting downhill and gets to the basket.
Yeah, I mean, you could see the well-rounded offensive nature of RJ Barrett's game just in a stat line. 26 points, 7 assists. That's a career high. Now, obviously, it's a small sample size of just 6 games, but 7 assists, 5.3 rebounds. He's contributing all across the floor. I'd have to imagine with Quickly back, the assists, the playmaking responsibilities will come down a bit, but still, a really great season for him. Let's say if Luka, you are the Lakers and you're trying to prepare to defend this Raptors team, what are the keys? What do the Lakers have to really be aware of? How are the Raptors giving teams problems?
Yeah, so I think, you know, the Raptors have actually done a really good job in the paint. And even when the Raptors last matched up against the Lakers, surprisingly, they won that points in the paint battle, despite AD having a field day. So I think the Raptors, they are being very aggressive attacking. Like, Grady Dick has become all of a sudden one of the, you know, better finishers around the basket. Like, his layup package has been incredible. RJ likes to be aggressive. You know, Emmanuel Quickly, he's more of the outside perimeter shooter, but I think the Raptors have done a lot of their damage inside. They do a lot of sets where they are looking to attack. And really, the Raptors got to do a better job hitting the three. And I think, you know, the Lakers did a good job in that department of running, you know, the Raptors off the line. And or when the Raptors were taking three-point attempts, you know, they just weren't falling. They shot at 28.6%. But I think the paint is going to be a big thing. And, you know, neutralizing you know, Barrett in particular and Grady, because those guys were killers, especially on the wing. I mean, Grady was giving you guys all sorts of problems. So now that you're adding another scoring attack in Quickly, it'll be interesting to see how the Lakers manage that on the defensive side. But I'm interested to see this matchup going, Trevor, and it seems like it is a theme, at least from the Raptors perspective. I got to bring this up because remember when these two teams played last season in Los Angeles, it sparked the whole Darko Rajakovic ran after about the foul.
That's right.
And I'm looking at the free throw discrepancy in this first game. That was a big talking point on the Raptors side of things, that the Lakers had 41 free throw attempts, the Raptors 13. And I think that number was pretty substantial in the fourth quarter. So the Raptors although they are attacking, they haven't been getting a whole lot of free throw attempts. And this is not just against the Lakers. It's just a kind of a season theme for them. So obviously that's going to be a big thing, because for the Lakers, you know, having Anthony Davis and LeBron, who just notoriously owns this Raptors team, you know, that's, this is going to be a team you would think is going to get a lot of free throw attempts.
Yeah, you can see it right here. Points in the paint for the Raptors. They are second in the NBA in points in the paint right now. The Lakers sitting fourth when it comes to points in the paint. So that's, I mean, this is going to be a paint battle. We can even take a look at opponents' points in the paint. Does either one of those teams give up a lot of buckets at the rim? Not so much. The Lakers sitting 28th. And did I miss the Raptors? Where are they at?
They're like hidden on this list.
They're not number one. Where did the Raptors go? Where are the Raptors with their they're right there. I don't know how I missed them there. So the bottom line is both teams are really good scoring in the paint, and they're really good preventing teams to score in the paint. So we're going to have a paint battle here between these two sides.
Yeah, what's the over-under going to be for threes? Because I think we're going to get all the scoring inside this game.
Well, let's take a quick look at that. When we talk about three-pointers attempted, the Lakers were bottom in the NBA last I looked. They moved right up. There. Oh, they had a game where AD was out a couple of games ago, and that was against Memphis, and they put up, like, I think it was 48 threes, so that pulled them up. So they're 26, and the Raptors also 26th, tied in three-pointers attempted per game. So both teams, though, in the bottom five in three-pointers attempted, both teams in the top five in points in the paint, and both teams are pretty good at stopping teams from scoring in the paint. So this is going to be, it's a little bit of a mirror match in that way, that they're both teams are good at the same things. That's going to create a really fascinating battle for this one.
Yeah, especially, you know, when you look at Anthony Davis, like his last game against the Raptors, 38 points, 12 rebounds, like he was just a beast. So I think that's going to be an important matchup, even for Jakob Poeltl. Poeltl was big in that last matchup against the Lakers. He's actually been really good for the Raptors, and a big reason why their paint production has gone up dramatically, because I feel like when Poeltl's got his A game going, he had a little bit of a, I want to say, off game compared to his other games against the Kings. When he has his A game going inside, it just, the Raptors are running their offense, you know, a lot of sets with Poeltl, whether it's in the pick and roll. He just opens up so much when he's particularly having a good game inside and finishing on those nice little touches around the rim. So yeah, this is going to be an old fashioned battle in the paint.
It'll be as JR would say, a slobber knocker. So when we look at like the free throws attempted, which you mentioned, the Lakers shoot on average almost three free throws attempted per game, but the Raptors aren't like crazy low here. They're 11th in the NBA in free throw attempts per game. But again, when you're one of the top teams in points in the paint, you expect the free throw number to be up there as well. So that'll be something certainly to keep an eye on. Neither team shoots a lot of threes. Both teams love to score in the paint. You know, the only other thing I want to take a look at here, Luca, what have the Raptors been doing in terms of their pace? Have they been a team that's been flying? Because that's been an issue. There they are. Yeah, seventh in the NBA in pace. The Lakers have really struggled to stop teams from scoring in transition, and teams have been having a field day. Even on made baskets, teams are running on the Lakers. Do you expect to see the Raptors being able to take advantage of that?
Well, I think even having, you know, somebody in Emmanuel Quickley, that's just going to continue to add to, you know, the type of pace the Raptors like to play with. And yeah, this is a team that, you know, they have actually done a good job, points off turnovers, getting out, running.
They're second in the NBA.
What category is that?
In fast break points scored, the Raptors second in the NBA. That's one of the ways that I'm sorry to cut you off. That's one of the ways that your points in the paint numbers shoot up, because we think of points in the paint as throwing the ball into the post. Anthony Davis, Jakob Poeltl going head to head in the post. But teams really bump up their points in the paint numbers when they're getting out on the break a lot, because they're getting layups and dunks in transition, and those are points in the paint. So maybe not a surprise, but the Raptors, yeah, they're one of the best teams at scoring in the fast in the open court. So that's going to be interesting to watch too.
And I'm glad you mentioned that, because that's something that gets lost. Because although, you know, Poeltl, he has been doing a good job, it's not like he's like the Anthony Davis of the Raptors. A lot of the Raptors' damage has come, just like you said, like Grady Dick, RJ, really pushing, attacking, finishing around the rim. So I think this is going to even be a bigger threat for the Lakers, again, with Emmanuel Quickley, who likes to push it. Also, you know, with RJ in particular, like, he has just been in a whole different mindset, it seems. Like, he's been super, super aggressive. And, you know, he and Dick in particular, like, they have been really, really doing a lot of their damage inside. So, yeah, I think Quickley's just going to add to that. Obviously, he's going to help their three-point shooting as well. And pace probably is going to be an issue for the Lakers because, you know, even the last time these two teams met, that first quarter, like, if the Raptors don't get off to that bad of a start, remember, like, this was a tight game, like, in the second half.
Sure.
The Raptors had a chance there, you know, in points of the fourth quarter before the Lakers ultimately put it away.
Yeah, it's definitely going to be an exciting battle. You know, I thought Jakob Poeltl last game was a guy who he put up a big night in terms of his numbers. I don't recall them off the top of my head, but they were quiet. Like, you didn't notice it. And then you look up and you go, oh my gosh, Poeltl's having a monster night. He's a guy that could certainly cause some problems for the Lakers in the paint. They've got the guys in the perimeter. Their ability to drive and kick is going to be showcased in this one. So should be a really great game. And I'm going to break down the Lakers side of things in just a moment, as well as talk a little bit about the trade front. But Luca, thank you so much for coming on here and giving us some insight into your Toronto Raptors.
Thank you so much, Trevor. Always a blast being over here on the Lakers Nation. And yeah, it should be a great game between both teams.
And everybody, make sure you check out Raptors Nation. You can click the link in the description down below. I'll be right back and we'll jump over to the Lakers side of things. The Lakers are back. We're living and dying with every play, and that means a lot of stress as well as a lot of stink. Fortunately, you can let Mando be your MVP. They offer 72-hour odor control across a variety of products. You've got the invisible spray, the solid stick, the invisible cream in terms of their whole body deodorant. They come in four different scents to choose from, so plenty of options there to suit your taste. Plus, new customers get $5 off a starter pack with our exclusive code. Use code LakersNation at shopmando.com, shopmando.com. I'll tell you what, my favorite product from Mando, and they've got a wide variety of them, definitely recommend going and checking them out, but it's the deodorant wipes. So easy to grab and go. You go to the game, you want to go out to the bar afterwards. These can be an absolute lifesaver. So again, check out those deodorant wipes. And again, Mando has their starter pack that is perfect for new customers. So if you're just trying them out or you want a last minute stocking stuffer, it comes with a solid stick deodorant, cream tube deodorant, two free products of your choice like mini body wash and the deodorant wipes that I talked about, plus free shipping. And again, I've got that discount code to get you hooked up on my favorite smelling whole body deodorant on the market. New customers get $5 off a starter pack with our exclusive code. That's over 40%. Off your starter pack with code LakersNation at shopmando.com. That's shopmando.com. Let them know that we sent you guys. Again, shopmando.com. Let them be your MVP. Okay, let's get into the Lakers side of Lakers-Raptors tonight. Big game. Lakers need to make sure they get a win in this one. Not going to be easy. I want to break down the Lakers side of the matchup, but first, I did say that we would talk a little bit about the trade front and what that's looking like for the Lakers. So again, I'm putting this in the middle of a show all about Lakers Raptors. So obviously this is not like earth shattering stuff here, but worth noting. We're not really in trade season right now, but this is worth noting. Jake Fisher was on the Bleacher Report app and said the Lakers are still going to be in the market for a center. Again, that is nothing new. We've been hearing that since the summer. They're looking for a big. JJ Redick uses the phrase bruiser. That's what they're looking for a big physical presence in the paint. But two names that Fisher threw out there, Brook Lopez from the Milwaukee Bucks and Jonas Valanciunas for the Washington Wizards. So there's some real challenges for both those guys. I can't say that either of those guys are near the top of my list in terms of center targets. Brook Lopez, obviously we remember from his time in LA, has been really good for the Bucks over the years. The problem is he's not 36 years old. He's 36 years old, making $23 million. That's not, look, if you're, Fisher added that D'Angelo Russell would be an outgoing salary for the Lakers. So D'Lo's making $18 million and change. It's not impossible to get to that $23 million number when your base that you're playing off of here is $18.7 million for D'Angelo Russell if we round up. So you can get there, but there's some real hurdles for the Lakers in order to make a trade with the Bucks. And I'm not talking about whether or not they actually want Brook Lopez. Just let's say they do want Brook Lopez. How do you get a deal done? So the Bucks are a second-tier apron team, which means that they can't aggregate salaries together in a trade. So let's say the Lakers wanted to throw together a hypothetical trade of Rui Hachimura and D'Angelo Russell together. So we're talking about, what would that be? Like $35 million. And they want to bring back Brooke Lopez and Bobby Portis. Okay, roughly $35 million as well. Okay, the math may or may not work completely. That's just off the top of my head. But just purely hypothetical, not even talking about value or anything like that, purely hypothetical, let's say the Lakers wanted to make that trade. The Bucks can't do it. They're not allowed to aggregate any salaries, which means they can't package anyone with Brooke Lopez. They can't package anyone with Bobby Portis, with Pat Connaughton, and anyone else. They can only send out one player individually in a trade. That's it. And on top of that, one of the penalties of being a first-tier apron team, which the Lakers are, is that you cannot take back more salary than you send out in a trade. Now, the Knicks got creative and figured out a way around this by signing players off the street to go play, but that was also during the offseason in order to get Karl Anthony Towns. But that's a major complicating factor. And this is where I think the NBA blew it with the new CBA. I think they made a mistake. I think this goes way too far, and that this punishment, this penalty, should be a second-tier apron penalty, not a first-tier. Not a first-tier. Because here's the problem. What this effectively means is that first-tier apron teams, unless you're able to do something very creative like what the Knicks did, it's not that the Knicks did something that had never been done before, but still, they had to get pretty crafty to get it done. But otherwise, it makes it nearly impossible for two teams that are above the first-tier apron to trade with each other. Because, for example, the Bucks have the same restriction. They can't take back more salary than they send out in a trade. So how do the Bucks and Lakers trade with each other? They can't. One team has to take back more salary unless you find a way to get two salaries that are the exact same. So what you have to do is involve a third team. And that makes things even more complicated. And then you get to, do the Lakers even want Brook Lopez at 36 years old? I mean, let's face it, the Bucks are struggling for a reason. Right now, Brook Lopez is shooting 40% from the field and 26% from three. Well, the whole reason why you would go get Brook Lopez is for his three-point shooting, but and his ability to stretch the floor. And nobody's going to defend him if he's shooting 26%. So obviously his career tells you that number will come up, but what if he's just fallen off the age cliff? What if that's a thing? He's still blocking two shots per game, but I don't know. I don't know that he's the solution the Lakers need. He's also basically a one-year guy, right? Because this might be it for Brook Lopez. I don't know if he plays again after this season. If he does, he's certainly not getting $23 million. But yeah, I don't know. I'm not sold on Brook Lopez being the guy to go get or being a big upgrade for the Lakers, depending on, of course, what you have to give up to get him. And then the other one, Jonas Valanciunas. That's the other one Fisher mentioned. Jonas, look, everybody knows that the Wizards signed Jonas in order to trade him, that ultimately he will be traded. He's got really 2 years under contract because his third year, $10 million, is fully non-guaranteed. He is not trade eligible, though. One of the great things about SpotTrack, you hover over the lock next to his name, and you can see he's not trade eligible till December 15th. Part of the reason why, there's many reasons why trades aren't typical this time of year in November, but one of them is that most of the players who signed contracts over the summer are not trade eligible till December 15th. Some even later. Like, look at Corey Kispert. He's not trade eligible until July 1st. So he can't be traded this season. Lauri Markkanen, same thing, can't be traded this season. So Jonas Valanciunas, though, even if the Lakers called the Wizards right now, right at the second, said, hey, let's do a deal, they can't. Can't do it till December 15th. $9.9 million. I mean, that's, there you go. Gabe Vincent trade done, right? That's pretty easy. Obviously, I think the Lakers would probably have to attach something to Gabe, but that's interesting. So again, not the most earth shattering of trade news, but I've talked about this. The Lakers, we know they're trying to stay afloat until they can find a trade and maybe even trades, plural. So we are going to keep an eye on the trade market and see how that all plays out and see what the Lakers can do. But according to Fisher, they're still looking for a big, and those are two names that are on their list right now. All right, let's get into this matchup. Lakers, Raptors tonight. Again, big thanks to Luca Rosano of Raptors Nation for jumping on and giving us the Raptors side of things. Now, one of the things that we have to note here, the Raptors are on the second night of a back-to-back. They played the Clippers last night. They lost by two, 105-103, and Emmanuel quickly came back. Now, I don't know how many minutes he's going to play, if he's going to play against the Lakers tonight. We'll see. But the Raptors, here's the thing about the Raptors. And I think this is going to be really important. In fact, when I'm looking at my keys for the game, mental strength for the Lakers is going to be a big one. This Raptors team is losing lots of games, but they're not going away. They aren't getting their doors blown off and just that's it, they're done, game's over. No, they're fighting all the way through. They almost beat the Clippers. And the Clippers have been, I think, better than people expected. They're one spot above the Lakers right now in the standings in the West. They're on a four-game win streak, actually. But the Raptors gave the Clippers real problems and very well almost came back and won this thing. And then tripped over their own 2 feet at the end, threw the ball inbound twice. They were down three and inbounded the ball. The Clippers had a foul to give, so the Raptors inbounded the ball to Jakob Poeltl, which made sense because the Clippers were going to take the foul anyway. But then once the Clippers were going to foul down or up three, they threw the ball to Poeltl again with his back to the basket beyond the three-point line. So, of course, the Clippers just fouled him, and he missed the second free throw on purpose and then got his own rebound and almost put it back up and in. Was really close to sending the game to overtime, but it was just a strange decision for the Raptors to allow themselves to be put in that position by giving the ball to Poeltl and running the same play. Anyway, I won't re-break down that whole game, but the bottom line is that the Raptors they're losing games, and that's probably good for their tank race, but they're not getting blown out. You look at what they've done. Okay, they got blown out by Cleveland, but guess what? Cleveland's unbeaten. Had a big comeback win against the Brooklyn Nets last night. Cleveland is unbeaten. They beat the 76ers, but then look at the losses. Okay, they lost to Minnesota by 11. Minnesota's a good team. They lost by 2 to Denver in OT. They lost by 5 to Charlotte. They lost to the Lakers by 6. They lost to Denver again by 2. Sacramento got them after they beat Sacramento in overtime in Canada, in Toronto. Sacramento got them and beat them 122-107, but then they just lost last night to the Clippers by 2. Like, they're not... most nights, this team is not just getting blown out and, oh my gosh, the Raptors are so terrible. No, they were actually a pretty solid team. RJ Barrett has been great. Emmanuel quickly looked fantastic. Even hit a big three late against the Clippers. Emmanuel quickly changes a lot of things for them. Grady Dick has been really, really good for them this season as well. So I think mental strength is going to be important for this Lakers team. What we can't, and by that, I mean, they can't let off the gas pedal. We can't see the Lakers, if they get out to a big lead, do what they've done when they've gotten out to big leads, and that's take their foot off the gas and try to coast. Because the Raptors will not go away. They will keep pushing. And so if the Lakers are able to build a lead, like they did the last time they played the Raptors, this happened. If they're able to build a lead, they cannot just take the foot off the gas and expect to coast. Because the Raptors aren't just going to go, oh, you guys have a big lead? Okay, never. Well, all right, we'll live to fight another day. No big deal. It's the second night of a back-to-back for them, but it's not in this team's DNA to just go away. They're going to keep fighting all the way through. So they will get themselves back into the game if you let them. If you let them, they will get themselves back into the game. They have the scoring punch. They have the ability to do it. And one of the big keys for the Lakers, it's going to be the second chance scoring opportunities, because the Raptors are actually the best team in the NBA when it comes to second chance points. They score more second chance points than anybody else. They're really good on the offensive glass. So the Lakers rebounding is going to have to be good in this game. You've got to be a lot better, especially than you've been recently. And the guy I'm really looking at, it's Rui Hachimura, who's not been rebounding the ball nearly as well over the last few games as he has been, as he did, as he was to start the season. Rui Hachimura has got to contribute, particularly on the defensive glass. Anthony Davis is going to need help in there. Jakob Poeltl can be a physical presence. By the way, maybe another guy to keep an eye on the trade front for the Lakers, Jakob Poeltl. He had 6 offensive rebounds the last time the Lakers played the Raptors. The Raptors won the offensive rebound battle 15-9 last time the Lakers played them. So this is a team that can do real work on the glass and create second chance scoring opportunities. In fact, the Raptors last game took 107 shots. The Lakers just 88. Now the Lakers took 41 free throws that game to just 13 for the Raptors. So that's part of it. That's part of the reason why the Lakers field goal attempts are down so low compared to what we saw from Toronto. It's because they spent time at the line and, you know, spending possessions doing that, you know, going to the free throw line rather than taking a field goal. But nonetheless, this is going to be a battle. And so when I talk about mental strength, this Raptors team being one that isn't going to go away, it's also going to require that focus on the details. You have to box out. If you miss your box out, the Raptors are going to take advantage. They're going to take advantage way more often than not. So you've got to, if you're the Lakers, focus on being scrappy, getting to the loose balls, and making sure that you take care of the glass. Going to be so important in this game. Another key to take a look at in this one, again, last time the Lakers played the Raptors, it was a close game. The Raptors complained about free throw shooting afterwards. So can the Lakers count on a big free throw discrepancy this time? Maybe not. Maybe not. But I think the Lakers are going to have to get a big game out of Cam Reddish. You're going to need Rui to help you on the boards. You're going to need Cam. All the other guys are going to have to help. They're going to have to help Anthony Davis on the glass. No question. By the way, Anthony Davis, Jackson Hayes, both officially listed as probable for the game tonight. So feel pretty good they're going to play. But you're going to need the help of Cam Reddish, and you're going to especially need him to defend RJ Barrett. You look at what RJ Barrett did last time he played the Lakers. 33 points, 12 assists, 5 rebounds. He was fantastic for the Raptors. And then you look at what happened against the Clippers. I thought the Clippers did a really nice job defending RJ Barrett. 6 of 15, just 13 points for RJ Barrett. That's well below, he's averaging 26 points on the season. So he's coming off of a relatively cold performance. So RJ Barrett, you know, is going to look to get going. He's going to look to get going. He's going to want to drop 30. And the main responsibility with Jared Vanderbilt still hurt, it's going to fall on Cam Reddish to deal with RJ Barrett. That matchup, maybe it's not fair because Cam Reddish just got put into the starting lineup. And to count on him this heavily, it's tough, but that's the job. And it's going to fall on Cam Reddish to try to slow down RJ Barrett. Because here's the thing, they're still missing Scotty Barnes. They're still missing Kelly Olynyk. This is not a healthy Raptors team. But with Emmanuel Quickley, assuming he plays, RJ Barrett, they've got Grady Dick, they've got scoring punch. The Raptors can score the ball. You need to slow down probably 2 of those 3. And your best shot, your best defensive chance, I think, is Cam Reddish on RJ Barrett. Because Emmanuel Quickley is Austin. Austin's done okay defensively. Now, Jaden Ivey had his number, but other than that, Austin's done pretty well defensively on the season. But I would expect Quickley to be able to get the shots that he wants to get against Austin Reeves. Grady Dick, he's a young player. I don't think he's going to give them a ton of trouble. I mean, he can put up 20. He can certainly put up 20 on you. But how are you going to defend him? It's probably going to be Rui on him, I would think. And you're going to use Cam on RJ Barrett. And if Grady Dick happens to go nuts, then all right, you deal with it. We could see Cam on Grady, but I think you're going to use Cam on RJ Barrett and do what you can to slow him down. So I think that matchup's going to be really important in tonight's game for the Lakers. And that's the one that I'm really keeping an eye on. And again, it's a lot of responsibility on Cam, but I think he's up to the task. He's been playing really well lately. So I'm excited to see what that looks like. Again, this is not an easy matchup. You look at the Raptors' record on paper and you go, oh, the Lakers should have this thing. You go over to ESPN right now and the Lakers are a 10.5 point favorite for this. I think that's too high. Now, that's just ESPN. That's not the official sports book or anything, but still, I think this is game, even with the Raptors on the second night of a back-to-back, just given what this team's done and the way this team has scored points, I think it's going to be a difficult matchup for the Lakers. They should win. They should win, but it's not going to be easy. They're going to have to really show up and get the job done. So, can the Lakers do it? Can they approach this game with the necessary effort to get the win? Again, Raptors on the second night of a back-to-back, a home game for the Lakers. Those things should matter. The Lakers should walk away with the win. There's no guarantee. If they show up like they did against the Pistons, if they show up and they think, okay, we're here, hand us our win. Nah, the Raptors will take one. They will. If the Lakers don't show up ready to play. The Lakers show up ready to play and they approach the game appropriately, they should win this matchup. But I'll tell you, the Raptors are not going to make it easy. The Lakers are going to have a fight on their hands in this one tonight. All right, Lakers Nation, give me your thoughts on the game, on the trade front, anything else in the comments down below. Don't forget to subscribe right here to the Lakers Nation YouTube channel. Till next time, everybody. See you and stay safe.